Good morning. This is a joint work with Deepak, Barry, and Helmut from Ireland, from 4C. And this work deals with the design of energy-efficient data centers. So this is the outline of my talk. I will first give some context about the overall project and give you the exact problem formulation we are addressing in this work. And then I will move on a sub-problem, which is a variant of bin packing. And we believe this sub-problem is relevant for the application domain. So we want to study it. And this, we will discuss some lower bounds for this sub-problem and a constrained programming approach. And then I will move back to the application and try to show that what we learned was actually useful to solve the original problem, and especially to design a lower bound by column generation, and to assert the quality of the upper bounds we get with large numerical search. And then I will give an overview of the results. So the project, this energetic project, is actually a very large project where four big companies were involved: Schneider, Bull, Eolas, and UXP. And well, the context is the increase of energy price and the growing business in cloud computing. That's the main incentives to the design of energy-efficient data centers. I think you might be familiar with this domain because of the RODEF challenge of last year with Google. So basically, this is an overview of the project. So I just want to make it clear, we were not involved in this project initially. So that was done by, this project took place in Grenoble, and we only got involved for the solving part when they realized they were not able to solve the formulation they stated. So for their project, one of the main contributions was, for example, the design of good energy indicators to actually help managing the center. Another key point was the energy models. I don't know if you see the energy models, so they characterized each component of the center. Typically for servers, the energy model of a server was characterized as a linear consumption depending on the load, on the CPU load. So a server would have a fixed cost and a linear cost depending on the load. So the measures were performed on all the equipments of the centers. So the equipments here were provided by Bull, and they established the model of each component of the center. So typically, the problem is to assign virtual machines to servers over multiple time periods, and that's where we got involved, only on this tiny part. Okay, so the problem formulation is this one. You have each server has a CPU, a memory, and a cardinality capacity. So on this picture here, a big box is a server, and the height of the box is the CPU capacity, and the width is the memory capacity. And each small box is a virtual machine, and its height is the CPU consumption, and the width is the memory consumption. So the problem takes place over multiple time periods, okay? And the CPU consumption of a virtual machine can change over the time, is changing over time. So that this height is actually decreasing here because the demand is decreasing. Now the number of migrations is limited from one period to the next. So that means the number of virtual machine you can move from one server to another is bounded, the number of changes, and you want to minimize energy. And energy depends on the state of the server, whether they are on or off, on the load of the servers, on the CPU load of the servers. You also have a cost for changing a server from on to standby and from standby to on, so you pay a cost for that, an energy cost, and you have a cost for migrating a virtual machine. So if I want to tell you the problem in one sentence, that's how I would put it. I would say it's a series of consecutive cost-aware bin packing problems. And all these bin packing problems, that's the time, t minus one, t, the periods, are linked by the migration constraints. So if you want, one way to put it would be to say that all these bin packing problems, they are related, they are linked by the migration constraints, so these are the coupling constraints. And if the bin packings are easy, they are the complicating constraints. Okay, so when you see this picture, one thing you want to do is you feel, okay, I would love to study the restriction of the problem to one time period. Because if I can solve this restriction well, the door is open to a lot of decomposition and relaxation strategies by relaxing these constraints, the coupling one. So if I'm able to solve the one period problem, yes, that's kind of, well, that's what we wanted to do. So in the, I will now move on this specific sub-problem. So what is it? This problem is a bin packing, but we have a cost. So we call it here bin packing with usage cost. So it's very simple. You have the set of items with integer sizes, and you have a set of bins. And the bins have three parameters: a capacity, here a fixed cost, and a usage cost. So capacity is a fixed cost that you pay for using the bin, and the usage cost is that you pay per unit of load used on the bin. So the cost of a used bin would be, if the bin is used, you would pay the fixed cost plus the load times the usage cost. And you want to minimize the sum over all costs, over all the bins, sorry. So is that clear? Yeah? Okay, so this is an example, a simple example. You have five bins and some items. And for this example, I have put the fixed cost to zero. So the capacity is 9, the fixed cost is 0, and the usage cost is 1. Okay, in this example. So a solution for, I show two solutions for this problem. In the first solution, I am using 4 bins, and in the second one, 5 bins. So in the first solution, I have put the items of size 2 on the first bin. So 8 units of space are used, so I pay 8 times 1, plus 3 times 2, and so on. So the cost of the first solution here is 26. And the cost of the second one is 25. So actually P2 here is better than P1, even though it's not using the minimum number of bins. But it is actually filling the cheapest bin as best as possible. Okay, so this is the problem I want to study. So since the cost is a new part of the problem, I want to work on lower bounds. That's my starting point. And a very natural way to start is to look at a very simple linear formulation of the problem and to extend it with cost. Well, a very simple formulation of the bin packing problem and to add cost. So this is a standard model for bin packing, where the xij tells us whether item I is placed on bin j, and yj tells us whether bin j is open. And I'm just adding the fixed cost here and the usage cost depending on the load. So the load is the sum of the sizes times the Boolean variable. Okay, that's very simple. Now, if you look at this formulation, it's very easy to characterize the linear relaxation. And so that's actually is very useful. If you look carefully, if you fill a bin perfectly, then the cost of one unit of space, if it's filled perfectly, is going to be the fixed cost divided by the capacity, and the cost of one unit of space, plus the usage cost. So I call this value Rj for bin j, okay? And if I want to get the linear, the bound of the linear relaxation, I just sort the bins by non-degreasing Rj, and I fill the cheapest bin by splitting the items. Very simple. I show you an example now. So there is a lot. There are a lot of numbers, but you don't need to look at them all. Just notice that I have bins of different capacities, and for each of them, I have put the fixed cost and the usage cost. And below that, I computed the R values. So for the first bin, fixed cost is 9, capacity is 9. So 9 divided by 9, that's 1, plus 5, that's equal to 6. And what I do, I apply my lower bound. So I sort them by increasing Rj. So the cheapest one is the third bin with R3 equal 5. So they are sorted by non-decreasing Rj. Yeah? And the bound, well, the total load is 18. So three items of size 5 and one item of size 3, that's 18. And I fill the cheapest bin first. And the bound tells me, well, I'm using 7 units of space for a cost of 5 per unit of space, 3 units of space for a cost of 5.33, so overall, it makes 99. So this gives me the bound of the linear program I just presented. The issue with that is that the optimal value is actually quite far from this bound. And why so? Because you cannot make 7 with 5 and 3. So you will have wasted space in the optimal solution here. As a result, one bin will not be used because you pay a fixed cost for each bin. So you will actually skip this one. You to avoid using four and to only use three of them. So you actually don't use a bin that was support, that was a support of the lower bound of the linear program. So how can you improve that? Well, if you look at the literature for bin packing, there are much more powerful models. One, the original one, is the Gilmore and Gomori model, where a variable is the packing itself of a bin, and you can extend this model with cost. And this would give you a very powerful lower bound. Another model is the model of Carvalho, which is called the arc flow model. So it's casting the problem into a flow with side constraints, and you can also extend this model to add the cost that I just mentioned. And if you do that, in the end, you know the best bound you get is this one, it's the Gomori, and which is strictly better than the one of the Carvalho, which is better of the one we just presented. So we have also implemented this and all these models can be used to solve the problem exactly as well. So the issue here is that we want to solve this bin packing with usage cost for large instances first, and with side constraints, cardinality and another dimension, memory. And the issue with Gilmore and Gomori, although they look very powerful for pure bin packing, they are not easy to extend with side constraints because they are very tailored for the pure bin packing problem. So we really want to use this formulation. And the nice thing about this is that we know how to compute the bound of the LP. So we can, since the gap is large, we can do a bit more. The idea is that since we can compute the bound very efficiently, maybe we can perform propagation on it, and maybe it's worth extending the bin packing global constraint with a cost model. So we thought, okay, we can extend the bin packing with a specific cost model and maybe improve this bound by performing propagation. So I just want to show you that now. So, but this is the motivation. So if I come back to my example, what filtering can I do? Well, I can use my bound very easily to update the minimum and maximum possible filling of each bin that would be due to the cost. Typically, I can very easily, if I have an upper bound, so to start reasoning, I need an upper bound. Let's say I have an upper bound of 130. I can very easily deduce that I need 1 unit of space used on this bin. Because if not, the 7 units here would go there, and it would overload my upper bound. That's very simple. Yeah? So, six is fine, 6 would go, but 7 would not. It would overload my upper bound. So that, if I do that as well on the third bin, I can also get 1 unit here. So now I know that this bin and this one must be open. So I can use their fixed cost completely, and that will increase my bound. That's where I get some gain. Because now here I had 1 unit of space, so I was not counting the fixed cost fully in my bound. So now I count the fixed cost, and I put a fixed cost that is 0 there to restrict the problem, and I apply the bound again. This will change the ordering of my R values, and this will give me a new bound. And when I do that, until I reach a fixed point, I get this information that this bin must be filled at least with 3 units, and this one cannot have more than 3 units. So overall, the filtering I do is that for the bins that are a support of my initial lower bound, I can update the lower bound of the filling. And for the bins, the others, I can update the upper bound of the filling. And overall, I can do that. So the computing the lower bound is logarithmic in the number of bins, and filtering for one bin is O of M, the number of bins. So it would be quadratic if you do it for all the bins. Another very simple reasoning that I can do that is not done by default by the bin packing global constraint is to use dynamic programming to update the minimum and maximum possible filling of each bin due to the item sizes. That is usually considered too costly, so the bin packing does not do it by default. But in this case, it really affects the cost, so it's actually more important. And when you do that, you can do that also for the LP model, for the MIP model at the root node, you can tighten the capacities by dynamic programming. If you do that, what you get at the root node, without branching at the root node, the LP bound would raise to 114 and the CP bound would raise 120. So the CP bound is the LP bound plus propagation until a fixed point. And of course, when you update the loads, then you trigger the bin packing global constraint to remove or assign items to bin. We don't filter the item variable because the cost model is only dependent on the bin. So we update the load variables of the bin. And we let the bin packing global constraint do its job, which is to filter the items variable. I don't know if I am clear. Okay, so if you look at some results, so I have implemented the three models I mentioned, the cutting stack, Arcflow, the MIP. So you would have some symmetry breaking and so on. I don't go into details. And the cutting stack is the one that, so this is only the lower bound and not the exact. So the best lower bound is here. And this is the number of problems that were not solved optimally, this 9 by the MIP. And this is the number of problems where it was not able to find even a feasible solution because it gets very large. So CPE is good at scaling for these large instances. So that's what we want. Now, probably the best exact algorithm would be the branch and price that I did not implement here. But I need to handle site constraints anyway, so it's a CP looks like a good candidate for this problem. Okay, I have finished with my sub-problem, so I move back at the higher level to the application. So you remember, I have this problem with site constraints over multiple time periods. So what we did overall is we already Deepak, Barry, and Helmut already performed some work on this problem for last year. The RODEF challenge is actually, it looks very like this problem, okay, but for one time period. So they actually generalized their algorithm to handle multiple time periods, and we were able to get very upper bounds for our application. So we did not put too much, well, we did put some effort, but this was reusing the work of last year. And to assert the quality of this solution, we implemented a lower bound by column generation using the, as a pricing problem, the bin packing with usage costs. And if overall, I talk now of the lower bound, overall, in this lower bound, in this model, a column, a variable, is a bin packing. It's not one packing of a bin, it's a period. It's a complete period. That's one variable. So that's a bit ambitious, but well, we wanted to try. And when you do that, the pricing problem, it can be very well described with bin packing with usage cost. So with four global constraints, bin packing, global quality, and bin packing with usage cost, you model very well the pricing problem. Now, you might object that the pricing is completely intractable here. So what are we doing? But the fact is that we are only looking for a lower bound. So we don't need to solve the pricing exactly. So we only need a lower bound on the pricing problem to get a lower bound of the original problem. So if I move to the results, the benchmark we had from the industry partners where we had only 74 instances. For one time period, it was like 242 virtual machines, 20 servers, and nearly 300 time periods. So it's not big if you look at one time period, but when you multiply by 300, it gets very big. And I have put some sample of the results here for difficult instances, where you have the number of items of virtual machines, the number of servers, and the number of time periods. And you have, for the lower bound, you have three algorithms, the initial LP, the column generation, and the MIP LB is, we take the lower bound after 10 minutes of search of the MIP, because it has a lower bound, so we take this one. So the time limit is 10 minutes. So if you look at the lower bound, you see even after 10 minutes of search in the first instance, the MIP is not able to reach the lower bound of the column generation that we get only in 15 seconds. And it's much better than the LP relaxation, of course. And when it gets large, well, you cannot even solve the linear relaxation, so you cannot solve the MIP either, but we can still get something out of the column generation, even if it reaches the time limit. We still have a bound. And for the upper bound, this allows us to assert the quality of the solution that we get by large neighborhood search that was also implemented for the application. Okay, so this is my conclusion. What we did is that we tried to study a key variant of bin packing that we call here bin packing with usage cost. Well, it's only adding a cost model to bin packing, because we think this problem is relevant for this application domain, or our industry partners thought so. And we characterize a simple LP band and design some very simple, it's very simple, but you have to start from somewhere, cost-based propagation. And we propose an extension of the bin packing global constraint to actually handle that. Now, this gives a very effective exact solver for the bin packing with usage cost, and especially when you want to scale to large problems, because it remains quite fast to compute the lower bound, and you add set constraints. And on the application side, well, we designed a lower bound that is reusing somehow these results, maybe this lower bound is actually very, very simple, but it has some generality for this application domain, I think, where you have this multiple time period problem related by coupling constraints. And this allowed us to assert the quality of LNS on this benchmark. And what we do now is, if you notice, the benchmark is quite small for one time period. I think initially our industry partner could not solve tiny problems, so they actually didn't grow their benchmark too much. And we are also trying to solve much bigger problems with the same approaches. And we can scale easily to four times bigger. Well, easily, not easily, but this, what I described, also works for problems that are four times bigger. And yes, that's it. Thank you.
Again, you need to give a second round of applause. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Questions, please. I have a question. Peter.
You can have one as well. I just saw a hand raising. So no, I didn't. I'm sorry. I didn't get exactly what you mean. It's the echo.
Don't speak too loud.
I don't. So we are actually submitting this to the JCON conference. So that has been accepted with this benchmark, much larger benchmark. So they know we can, what we wanted is to have more than something greedy, to have a lower bound, so to actually prove that we were not blind.
Deepak actually wants to say something because he was hopping up and down.
Yes, this is what we are doing. We submitted to JCON. So that's a data conference, that's a data center conference.
Programming, right? We have actually a whole bin packing session.
Yes.
This year. And on a, you know, we know a global constraint becomes useful because if it is reused.
Yeah.
How reusable do you think this is?
Okay, so for me, if this cost model of a server has some generality for this application domain, then it makes sense to have it in the global constraint. So that I cannot claim it. That's what we had four industry partners that says, okay, the cost model is, they perform the regression, they said it's linear. So that's why we went that far. But now if someone is not using it again, I agree. If the cost model doesn't occur again, yes, it's a bit limited. But it is a very pure cost model with a fixed cost and usage cost.
And actually, I mean, if you were to add it to the bin packing global constraint, it's not that hard.
No. Actually, it's very simple reasonings. Yes, it's not that hard, and it's it's orthogonal to the bin packing reasonings. It doesn't affect them. You could use the
Amazon EC2 cost model. That's the actual price you pay.
As the Amazon cost model. Ah, okay.
It's not cost model.
To me, okay. Okay.
Okay, let's thank the speaker again.